attendance, and I don't have a microphone. Now I have a microphone. Thank you for coming. We received a call from Christina this morning that Jean was on her way out to the car, and she's getting so weak that she couldn't make it to the car. So she was on her way over to help them, and she was sitting on a stool in the garage. So just we'll keep Jean in our prayers. So they won't be here this morning, but they'll be on the conference call this evening is the plan. So at this time, I'd ask you, if you will, to bow with me in a word of prayer. Heavenly Father, we come to you this morning to praise you, to thank you. Thank you for Jesus and what he means to us and the hope that we have within him. The promises that you've given us, the guidance that we have for life. We pray that you'd help us to know your will, to study your word, and we thank you for the Bible in its written form. And personally, I thank you for living in the time that I live in, and rather than back in the first century time. Thank you, Father, for all the blessings that you've given us. We humbly ask you to forgive us where we sin. We pray that you would strengthen us where we're weak. Help us to recognize those weak spots that we might do better. Father, we thank you for the opportunity to come together this morning to worship. We'd ask you to help us as we enter into this hour of worship, that the messages that are presented, the lessons that are here, that we'd listen and we'd pay close attention as Scott delivers those lessons to us. We thank you for his abilities. We thank you for the talent that's within the congregation to do the various things that need to be done in the acts of worship and the maintaining of your congregation here. Father, we thank you, and we ask you to help us as we reach out to people around us, even during this time of COVID, that you'd help us to be evangelistic minded, to take the precautions that we know we need to do, but yet be bold in the sense of reaching out to people and studying that we might present the message, the good news of your Son. We thank you again for the many blessings that you give us. We ask you to be with us as we leave this assembly this morning, that the things that we do, the decisions that we make, are in harmony with your will. Father, we want to live for you. We love you. We care for you. And we pray for those folks that's on the prayer list. We pray especially for Jean this morning, that you would help her and help the family. And those others that are unable to be with us, there are so many, Father, but just off the top of my head, we pray for Larry. We pray for Jerry and Kathy. We pray for Holly. And I'm sure I'm missing some. But Father, you know who they are. We just ask your blessing on one of those people. Through your Son's name we pray. Amen.
Praise Him, O ye heavens of heavens, and ye floods above the sky. Let them praise His name, Jehovah, for His name alone is high, and His glory.
here. And for those that are helping us in service, Dave leading prayer, Jeremy leading singing. But as we are gathered here together, and there are many things we can focus upon, and as Mike will bring a lesson from God's Word, we also have a time in our worship to focus upon Christ, specifically on Christ and about his death. For us as Christians to remind ourselves what that death did for us. And so, 1 Corinthians 11, Paul would write to those in Corinth of the importance of this supper, of how they were to do it and why they were to do it. They were to do this in remembering Christ's death until he comes back. And so as often as they were meeting, and as we meet here on the first day of the week, we do this each and every week to remind ourselves of Christ and his death. So if you would, please bow with me at this time. Heavenly Father, we do thank you so much, and we're so blessed. Lord, we're thankful for what you've done for us spiritually by sending your Son to us and for us, Lord, of having paid the price for our sins. Lord, it is that body that died on the cross for us. Lord, may we remind ourselves of that as we partake of this bread that symbolizes your Son's body. Lord, we ask this in Jesus' name. Amen. Part of the Lord's Supper not only is the bread and the body of Christ, or it reminds us of Christ and his death, or the beatings that he had taken, but we also read in the New Testament about Paul, and we read about how he suffered for the church and how he was trying to get the message to people, the good news of salvation. But it is Christ and his death that again brings us that salvation, that message that Paul would then take. And so it wasn't just a beating of the body, but it was that blood that was shed on the cross for us that we must remind ourselves about. So if you will please bow with me again. Heavenly Father, again we come to you thanking you for you being our Father, for being our God, and having sent your Son to us. Lord, not only did he teach, not only did he perform miracles, but Lord, he would give his life as a sacrifice for us. Lord, and not just for temporary pain, but the pain of losing a life and having that blood shed on the cross and the crown of thorns. Lord, as we just think about all that he did, so it would be possible that we may have eternal life with you one day. May we be thankful each and every day. May we be thankful as we partake of this fruit of the vine. We ask this in Jesus' name. Amen. Another thing to make mention of as we're gathered together and we're singing, we're encouraging, teaching one another, as again Mike will bring us the lesson today, as we study God's Word, as we're reminded in prayer who we ought to be thanking about, how we can thank God for the blessings in our life. So it is that we see the early church gathered together and they collected funds to support the work of the church, those who needed it. And so that message could be continued out, and so more and more people could hear God's word. If you saw coming in, as we had in the past few weeks, there is the plate out front. If you were unable to do that as you came in, please do that on the way out. We'll have a word for the giving at this point. Please bow with me. Heavenly Father, again, we just ask that we be humble people, we be thankful people, realizing all that we've been blessed with. And Lord, as you continue to bless us financially, Lord, we continue to give back, Lord, for the church in this area. Lord, that it'd be an opportunity for us to take care of the needs and the works here. Lord, that we'd be able to see brothers and sisters near us and around us that need the help as well. Lord, it'd be an opportunity to stretch out to the lost, and I just ask, Lord, that all that we do be pleasing in your sight. Lord, we're so thankful, and we ask these things in Jesus' name. Amen.
But the
say that he never votes. This country, that's one of the great things about this country, is we can have our voice heard by voting. And by voting on, we vote on issues, we vote on taxes, we vote on candidates, and we have that opportunity. We vote on changes in law sometimes even. And we have the opportunity to do that in this country. Do you know in other countries that people line up, it's convenient for you. I can drive my car to the poll, and I can park, and I can go in and vote. Now here, all you gotta do is mail in and request a ballot, and then mail it back to them. Don't even have to go anyplace in person. And they're even taking extra extreme measures with the COVID thing. But we in this country take it so for granted that we don't do that. There's people in other countries that drive walk miles to get to vote. It's simple for us to do it. And we don't take advantage of it like we should. And Psalms, chapter 33, verse 12. Blessed is the nation whose God is the Lord. Blessed is the nation whose God is the Lord. Are we a blessed nation? Beyond my understanding, we're spoiled. We're a spoiled nation. But blessed is the nation whose God is the Lord. I'm afraid we live in a nation where we're moving away from that. We don't recognize him. We have politicians that don't even want to acknowledge that name. They don't even want to, they won't quote the Bible. They just want to ignore it. They want to pretend like it doesn't exist. That's what this country was built on. It was God's word. It was religious values, Christian values. And we have people in power, people who are making decisions now, that don't even want to acknowledge it. They won't even mention it. We have a way to let that know, to let them know what our feelings are about that. We need to make sure our voices are heard. It's been argued, and some people want to say, well, my vote doesn't matter. I said that myself. I forget, wasn't here a while back, and it wasn't a major election. And I was busy doing something else, and I didn't get in the car. And I didn't drive the three minutes it takes me to get to Brownsville. I didn't take the time to drive and do that. Because, well, it's not really, it's no big deal out there. You know what? I've repented of that. If I can do there and vote, I'm going to be there and vote. We have that privilege. We can't, our vote does matter. It makes a difference. Sometimes many nations don't have that right and privilege. We have many countries that are we have many men and women who have fought and died to give us that right to vote. That's part of the reason we have that. People have given their lives so that I can vote. And yet there's been times when I haven't got in the car, driven 3 minutes, gone in, taken 5 minutes to vote, and driven 3 minutes back home because I was too busy with something too important. It was wrong of me to do that. Men and women have fought and died, so we have that right in this country. We need to get out and make sure our voices are heard. Somebody that votes has a right to complain. I've talked to people that are complaining about how things are being done. Well, did you vote? No. Then you don't have a right to complain. If you don't make your voices heard, you have no right to complain about it. You have that privilege. And I believe it's a responsibility and privilege that we have that. We tend to think about this more during presidential elections because that's kind of a big deal. And it is kind of a big deal. But we also need to be thinking about these things when the school board gets elected. In some ways, the school board has more power with our children, our grandchildren, than what the president does. The school board decides what is acceptable and not acceptable in the schools. They have more power. And who's coming? Who's being raised up? Who's going to be there to vote? Who's going to be there to make decisions after we're gone? It's going to be those kids that the school board is making those decisions about, isn't it? They decide who teaches. You know, some of the stuff you see that some of these teachers are presenting to kids today is concerning to me. And the school board is hiring the teachers and keeping those teachers employed that are making teaching our kids bad things. And we, as a kid, we look up to that teacher, and they can't do any wrong, and they know all things. You know, teachers know everything, don't they, Troy? No, they really don't. But when we're in those young formative years, we tend to really look up to them as knowing, as being all-knowing, kind of, don't we? But with this right and privilege comes responsibility. We need to know what the candidates are thinking, what their stance is on different things. Do you know where the candidates stand on homosexuality? Can we be one nation under God and allow homosexuality in the country? I don't think so. Do we know where our politicians stand on abortion? Murdering unborn children? Do we know where they stand on public prayer? Do we know where they stand on drug abuse and alcohol and the importance of family and freedom of religion? Do you know where the candidates stand? Have you put forth that effort to know what their stand is? The Constitution of this great nation has provisions in it to keep the government from dictating religion. We have people today that want to use it to keep religion from influencing the government. That's not what it was intended for. It's designed to protect religion. It's designed to protect freedom of religion, not freedom from religion. Do you know what your politicians stand on those items? Have you done your homework? There's many topics that are important to me, but they could change and we could still be one nation under God. They could take away my gun rights and we could still be one nation under God. That's pretty important to me. They could take away, they could affect workers' rights, and it can still be one nation under God. We can take away landowners' rights and still be one nation under God. And there's other rights that we have that they can take away, and we can still be one nation under God. But we can't be one nation under God with all these things out. Many things will separate us from God as a country. And again, we kind of talk about those: homosexuality, abortion. Candidates don't follow through with what they're saying they're going to do. Yeah, you know, you can go vote for so and so, but they don't. They make all these promises and they don't follow through with them. Sometimes that's true, but we're still making a statement about what is important to us if we vote. If we say, you know, if we vote, you said you were going to do this, so I'm voting for you, and then if you choose not to do it, that's all right. But we've made our statement about what we our stand on that. Voting lets them know how important it is to us. How do you find out what the candidates think? Certainly, I don't think you want to trust the media today, do you? Media has that distorted, they put their spin on it. I've been working on the fire department, retired from the fire department, and there were scenes that I was on as a firefighter, then when I watched remind the media that day. I'd encourage you to go to the candidate's website. See what they're saying. See what they're promoting. See what their thoughts and policies are. Look at the performance of a candidate in the past. What have they voted for in the past? What have they done in the past? Have they been active? Have they gotten things accomplished? What have they gotten accomplished? Have they gotten good things accomplished? Or have they gotten bad things accomplished? Have they been honest in their dealings? Have they been straightforward? Have they followed through as best they can? I really think a lot of politicians think have big plans. When they get in there, they can't accomplish what they want to accomplish. But are they making the effort? Have they made the effort? Did they keep their word? Have they helped the less fortunate? Have they helped them get up on their feet? Look at how their children are living. What kind of job did they do raising their children? To me, that's a perfect example of your character. What kind of person you are is how your kids turn out. Who do you have the most influence over in your life? Your children. Look at the politician's children and see how they're turning out. Romans chapter 1, verses 26 through 32. Romans 1, verses 26 through 32. It's going to talk about what happens if we don't make sure our voices are heard. Romans 1, verse 26. For this reason, God gave them over to degrading passion. For their women exchanged functions for that which was unnatural. In the same way, also the men abandoned the natural function of the women and burned in their desire toward one another, men with men committing indecent acts and receiving in their own persons the due penalty of their error. And just as they did not see fit to acknowledge God in any longer, God gave them over to a depraved mind to do those things which are not proper, being filled with all unrighteousness, wickedness, greed, evil, full of envy, murder, strife, deceit, malicious. They are gossips, slanderers, haters of God, insolent, arrogant, boastful, inventors of evil, disobedient to parents, without understanding, untrustworthy, unloving, unmerciful, and although they know the ordinance of God, those who practice such things are worthy of death. They do not only do the same, but also give healthy, hearty approval to those who practice them. This is talking about an individual, but it's true of a country also. It's true of a country. God's going to, if we don't follow God, if we don't try to stay to God as a country, as a society, have Christian values, God's going to just turn us over to these other things. We're heading that direction. A lot of our society wants these things to be okay. You know, I said inside the church, big things coming into the church wrong don't scare me near as much as the little things. They just keep getting in a little bit farther and a little bit farther and a little bit farther. And if we don't keep our eyes open for it in the think about certain candidates, I'd be more than happy to have this one-on-one question on that. I don't think that's appropriate for this. But I think we need to educate ourselves on what the candidates are promoting. If you have a need this evening, or this afternoon, whatever, this morning, if you haven't turned your life over to Christ, if you've fallen into bad ways, if you haven't accepted Christ as your Redeemer, you have that opportunity through baptism this morning to do that. If you have taken advantage of that, if you've become His child and you've stumbled and fallen, you can fix that. You can, if you need the prayers of the church for strength, for forgiveness, you have that privilege to do that now as we stand and sing.
There's a fountain of praises for you and me. Let us haste our ways to its spring. 'Tis the fountain of love from the source above, and He bids us all freely drink. Will you come to the fountain free? Will you come? 'Tis for you and me. Thirsty soul, hear the welcome call. 'Tis a fountain open for all. There's a living stream with a crystal gleam from the throne of life. Now it flows while the waters roll. Let the weary soul hear the call that forth freely goes. Will you come to the fountain free? Will you come? 'Tis for you and me. Thirsty soul, hear the welcome call. 'Tis a fountain open for all. There's a rock that's cleft and a soul is left that may not its pure water share. 'Tis for you and me and its stream I see. Let us hasten joyfully there. Will you come to the fountain free? Will you come? 'Tis for you and me. Thirsty soul, hear the welcome call. 'Tis a fountain open for all.
Maybe seated. Good morning.
Just a few announcements here that I see. Reminder that Potter's Children's Home has asked for donations for their pantry. Things like chocolate, Pop-Tarts, toilet paper, barbecue sauce, Velveeta cheese, canned diced tomatoes. They're going to be picking those up October 18th, so next weekend. So please, if you can help, please do so. Also, Mount Aloysius down in New Lex is asking for masks for their residents and staff, so if you can help there again, that would be awesome. Way out in the future, I know we've mentioned it a couple times, but I guess not way out anymore, but November 7th, that'll be the recycling. If you have any suggestions about restarting Sunday morning Bible classes, please see Dave or Mike, or if you have any concerns about that, please see them. Also, Barb was just mentioning to me this morning on our prayer list, our updated prayer list, Haley Smith, who just graduated a few years back from Sheridan, lives down the road, the south side of Market Street, has been in the hospital pretty bad actually, but she was out, is out of the hospital and doing well now, so that's great to hear. And then also, Barb mentioned Creed Bailey, who some,